Young men, have you any fish? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. This gospel that we're reading is actually going to be broken into two parts. Because if this is all the same chapter 21 of St. John, this Sunday's gospel and next Sunday's gospel. And so what we're going to do is next Sunday, I know it's the sound system, we're waiting for it to die. It comes on, I'm not even wearing a mic, it's only the one. So, it comes on and off, this one's plugged in. But like we told you, if we need a new sound system, the estimate is 16 grand. That we ain't got. So, we'll do the best we can. When it finally dies, I will walk up and down the middle aisle and just scream. Now, this question that our Lord asks, young man, have you caught anything? The term which is used, sometimes you'll see in the translations, we'll say fish. The lectionary we had for the reading today, have you caught anything to eat? In the Greek term, the word that's used literally means something to eat with bread. Kind of a strange term. But of course, in hearing it in the original Greek, anyone hearing the gospel would be completely echoing the idea of the Eucharist, just the very term being used. So that our Lord, the way it's written by St. John in the inspired text, is this unusual phrase, something to eat with bread. Bread would echo the Eucharist for anyone hearing. So we know what's being set up here is a large scene, more than just simply Jesus rose from the dead and meets his disciples. It's much larger. So we're going to lay out a few of the details of the scenario, and then next Sunday, we'll talk about, in the second part of this gospel being read, the dialogue that goes on. What is being said between these disciples and our Lord. Because, of course, in this gospel today, we have three things that we want to note. Distance, completion, and epiphany. St. John uses the term manifesting himself. The word in Greek is the epiphany. So he epiphanizes himself, he manifests himself. And as I mentioned to you numerous times, when St. John writes his gospel, his intention is to fill in some of the details that the other three don't give. Understanding that after decades of this gospel being preached and being read from the other three that have been written, St. John wants to fill in those holes for the believers. And so we have a detail where he says, this is the third manifestation of our Lord taking place. The other fascinating thing about this is that this is the end of the Gospel of St. John. And you'll see next week when the Gospel ends, it, knowing the rest of the story of the Ascension and Pentecost and everything, it seems to be kind of abrupt. It finishes with these disciples on the shore of the Sea of Tiberias, of Lake Genezareth. It terminates in the church. It terminates just simply in that living reality to everyone who hears this gospel, who listens to it being read, or who reads it. It finishes by terminating in the reality to which you already belong, which we call the church, this body of Christ. We talk about the question of distance or away. And he gives us the first part of being in the waters, this distance away from the shore. And we're told that the apostles, the disciples, we don't know, we know that five of these men who are in this boat are apostles. And then we're told there's two other disciples. They may be apostles, they may be other men as part of the inner circle of our Lord. We don't know, the names aren't given. But we're told that as they're coming in, they're about 100 yards away. So what is that then, a football field? So the distance is from the shore. It's not desperately far away, but they're shouting back and forth over the water to this man that they see on the shore. But they don't recognize him as being the Lord. And this is a detail which we've talked about over these last weeks. That in coming into contact with our Lord in his resurrected state, both for the people who are recorded in the Gospels, but also for us. We tend not to recognize him at first because of the disposition of our hearts. Not because of him. He doesn't change. He's unchanging, immutable, and glorious in his eternal life. But the distance that comes in, that when they have this miraculous catch of fish, and we don't really know why they don't recognize our Lord at first. Is it because it's dawn? So is it partially just simply the darkness, it's early morning? Is it the distance, the 100 yards? Or is it that spiritual dullness of sight? We don't know. Maybe it's a combination of all three. We're not sure. But St. John wants us to make sure that he knows that it's he who is the first one who says to Simon, hey, it's the Lord. And Simon, in his impetuosity, which you see throughout the Gospel, is lovely. Because he immediately jumps over the side of the boat. He doesn't even wait for the last 100 yards. He's just over the side. And the others, we're told in detail, figure that the better idea is to stay in the boat. And they row in the rest of their way. But that follows this third aspect of completion. When we use our word completion in English, we usually identify it with the word finish. You complete something, you finish something. In our minds, it's the exact same thing. But in fact, the difference between the two words, and they're both Latin in origin. So when we finish something, it means we arrive at the end of it. It's done. When we say to complete something, it means actually, well, complete the form. You fill out. Completion is filling out. And what is happening also in this Gospel of St. John is this is echoing and fulfilling the 3 years before when our Lord called these same fishermen off of these same shores of this same lake. And he said, do not be worried. I will make you fishers of men. You'll be gathering up people later on. So it echoes the end of the Gospel of St. John is a completion in that sense. The echoing. But it's also completing by the miraculous draught of fish, by pulling in these fish. So important it is, St. John gives us the number of the fish counted out, 153. And for the classical world of antiquity, numbers were really big for them. And we've mentioned to you because the numerical system in these ancient languages, Hebrew, Greek, and in the Syriac, they use the alphabetic letters to make also their numerals. So A is 1, B is 2, etc. So that you can take someone's name, calculate the number of the name because the numbers and the letters will be the same. Of course, probably most famously or infamously is the same author, St. John, writing the Apocalypse when he talks about the Antichrist, that his name is 666. So this number 153 is also important because 1 plus 5 plus 3 gives you 9. And 9 is 3 times 3. Now, St. Augustine will do an entire sermon on just the numerical values. Don't worry, we're not going to do that. But the 3 is the sacred number for much of the classical world, and certainly among the Hebrews, 3 and 7 are the two most sacred numbers that come up. So that you have 3 times 3 is the notion of completion and fulfillment of our Lord manifesting himself. And echoing in this completion, the call to be fishers of men. But he's also going to echo and complete the fact that when they get on the shore, he gives us a detail. There's a charcoal grill, barbecue going. This is also echoing. There's only 2 occasions in the entire New Testament we talk about burning charcoal. And this occasion is one of them. And the other one is echoing from earlier in this Gospel of St. John, the charcoal that was burning in the high priest's courtyard where Peter was the night of our Lord's arrest. And we know the tragedy around that fire was Peter to deny our Lord three times. Don't know the man, don't know the man, cussing and swearing, I told you before, I don't know him. So that's going to echo as part of this completion also. So we have bread echoing the Last Supper. We have this charcoal grill that our Lord has set up on the shoreline, which is echoing one from over just a month before. So there's a notion of completion. And St. Jerome then will talk about these fish. And St. Jerome in the 4th century, he claims, that the zoologist in the area said that there are 153 species of fish in the lake. So St. Jerome uses this number again and says, therefore this net represents the collecting of all out of this lake, signifying the indication of all the nations of the earth that are to be gathered up into the church. Again, the significance, they say that even though it was such an enormous catch, the net is not torn. The church is one, it's whole. All these little details that St. John is giving us. And the last is that this is a movement of men on water to a shoreline. And all the fathers interpret this as the waves, the water, has always represented, the sea represents the commotion, the instability of life in this world. And so the apostles in fishing on this boat are still very much in this world. And in their fishing, they bring in nothing all night long. It's also an aspect of the frustration of living in this world. Things don't often, certainly not usually, sometimes they do, turn out the way we want them to. So there's an aspect of the instability, the commotion, where they represent that our Lord on the shore is that stability, that immutability of the life of glory, of the life of eternity, and what is meant to be our participation in stability by the life of grace. So we have a contrast between these two. And then what we finish is this idea of the manifestation. That's what I leave you with the last detail. St. John, as we mentioned to you, gives 7 miracles in his Gospels. They're all highly geared to be pedagogical. They're meant to teach. So when he says this is the third manifestation, he wants us to understand something about these three that he has chosen. Because this is the third one, and it's the end of his Gospel. And it's finishing with the disciples and the catch, the reality of the church. So it's an ecclesiastical manifestation, if you like. So who are the other two? Well, the first is the beautiful recording of our Lord's epiphany, manifestation to Mary Magdalene, when she famously thinks he's the gardener, etc. That is the first manifestation, even before the apostles. He appears to this woman that we are told in the Gospel earlier had been possessed by 7 demons. This woman's previous life had been quite notorious and quite painful for her personally. And in his life of glory and of healing of the resurrection, he appears to her first. The second manifestation we had just recently with Delling Thomas, the week after Easter. Put your finger in my hands, put your hand in my side, and be no longer weak in faith, disbelieve me, but believe. Understand what's going on here. So he appears first to someone who had come from a very painful and broken background, spiritually, a laywoman. He appears to one of his apostles who doesn't quite get it unless it's personally proven to him, Doubting Thomas. And then this third manifestation is going to be ecclesiastical. And that's what we're going to look at next week, the dialogue that goes on between them. Quite famous, quite well known, and that our faith terminates in this ecclesiastical reality that we are sitting in right now. You are brothers and sisters, you belong to one body of Christ, that we have received the faith from our previous generation, contact with others who have received from before them, back to this episode that we read about today, 2,000 years earlier. This manifestation continues to this day. And what is given to us as that treasure is we are only the last link in this historical chain from this episode on the shore. And St. John is asking for us also to participate in the manifestation of Christ, and as a link in this chain, that we bring it to others, so that the same gospel will be read and understood and believed in the year 2110, when we're all pushing up daisies. That linkage, manifestation, is part of that reality of the life of grace given to us. It is a gift. It is an awesome responsibility. It does inspire awe. But it's one that he stands in stability of life and grace to give us the ability to participate in and then to give to others. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.